How many of you are at home in your pajamas or your slippers? Come on, be honest with me. I might look pretty up top here, but I've got my slippers on below because I'm coming from my home to yours to celebrate International Women's Day with World Denver. Thank you so much for being here. Oh my gosh, this is going to be an amazing event. There are powerful speakers lined up, and we are here in this energizer beginning session to get you warmed up and present for all the amazing sessions today. I'm Julia Beecham Kraft, and I mentor anxiety-prone women who are struggling with self-consciousness, perfectionism, performance anxiety, and who really want to be more confident in the spotlight. And see, that's what our speakers are going to be doing today, right? They're stepping into the spotlight, taking that risk to shine and speak up about what they're passionate about in order to inspire and motivate you. And I want you to have a taste of what that could be like for yourself here from the beginning of the day. Because I believe in the power of performance training to support women to find their inherent inner magnetism and intuition and power. Because when a woman allows herself to speak up, when she shines fully, the world is a little better, isn't it? Yeah. So let's do something here right from the beginning to get you into that powerful, positive state of being. Go ahead and stand up with me. Yeah, I said stand on up. Come on, no more computer time sitting on the couch. Stand on up with me. Stand up, stand up. Okay, here we are. Standing up. You've got space around you. Stand and relax your arms. Take a deep breath. Good. Now we're going to check in with a few different parts of you so that we can bring all of you present for today's event. First, check in with your physical body. How is your physical body? Does it feel energized? Is it achy? Is there anything your physical body needs to be more present today? How's your mind? Is your mind spinning or stuck on one thought? What does your mind need in order to be more present today? Take note. How about your heart or your emotions? What's on your heart today? And what do your emotions need in order to be more present, be fully present, to bring your passion and interest to today's event? And lastly, your overall energy level, 1 to 10, 10 being full of vitality, 1 being couch potato, blanket pulled up to here. Both are fine, but notice what you need to have enough energy to be fully present for today. And now we'll take a few deep breaths together to build your energy, your presence, and to support your body, right? Go ahead, do this with me. Take a deep breath in and a full breath out. Deep breath in and full breath out. Last one, deep breath in and full breath out. Very good. Even though we are miles apart in all areas of the world, we are breathing together. Let's do a little something for your body to wake up your body, because you're going to be sitting for a while today watching. So go ahead and stretch your arms out just in a way that feels like you're waking up in the morning. Nice, juicy stretch. Take a breath. And then keep stretching overhead. Stretch your arms up, 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 and then over to the side. A nice stretch that feels good to you. And then over to the other side. Nice, juicy stretch. Back to center, reach up, up, up. And drop the arms. Let the arms shake out, roll the shoulders, very good. The last thing that we'll do together to wake up your presence and your energy is called power poses. You've probably heard of this term before. It comes from Amy Cuddy's TED Talk. She's amazing. What it's getting at is that when we put our body into a position, it impacts our mood as well as our mindset. So try this with me, just as an experiment. If you put your arms up like this, which is a power pose, and your chest lifted and your chin lifted, what are you more likely to say? What are you more likely to do? What are you more likely to feel? Yeah, what do you start to feel even here? And if you cross your legs and cross your arms and take your head down and your chest down, notice my voice changes immediately too. What are you more likely to do? What are you more likely to say? What are you more likely to feel? Yeah, and what do you feel right now? So your body, your physiology can significantly impact your mindset. If you've been struggling with playing small or struggling to step out more and speak up more with for all the things that you're passionate about, this practice, however cheesy it may be, really can help you turn the corner of being willing to step out, yeah? So let's do it together. Take your arms up overhead, stretch, 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 all the way through your fingertips. Lift your chin a little bit, lift your chest a little bit, take a breath. We're gonna go further into the mindset work with power phrases. So repeat after me in your fullest, boldest voice. Here we go. I am confident. I believe in myself. When I speak, others listen. My voice and my presence has value. My voice as a woman has value. I believe in the power of women's voices everywhere. Yes. Oh, yes. And notice how you feel after that. Maybe it's a little cheesy to do this practice. It can make you smile and giggle, but wow, it's powerful. It works on a deep level to reset your mindset and your body. So I hope you feel ready and connected and present for today's event. Stay present throughout the day, and thank you for going through this energizer with me. I can't wait to see the talks. It's my belief that the world needs your voice.
Please welcome the Native American Women Warriors Color Guard for a special presentation of the flags. Please welcome World Denver's Board Chair, Barrett Walker.
Breathtaking, isn't it? On behalf of the 3.82 billion women around the world and the 1,000 plus joining us for today's live stream, welcome to World Denver's 9th Annual International Women's Day event. My name is Barrett Walker, and I'm proud to serve as World Denver's Board Chair, helping to build the leading forum for global affairs in Colorado. Each year, World Denver creates a theme around its International Women's Day event. This year, we celebrate women in all aspects of national security. However, before we dive into our program and meet the experts, I'd like to share a bit about World Denver. We're a nonprofit membership organization promoting international exchange, citizen diplomacy, and global engagement in our beloved Mile High City. Normally, in partnership with the State Department, World Denver Exchange programs would bring more than 600 international visitors from about 100 different countries to Denver to exchange ideas and expertise. But we all know this year has been anything but normal. As COVID hit, World Denver's team, their amazing team, quickly pivoted to create compelling virtual programming, understanding that its global-minded citizens, our members, would have a desire to stay connected to the important issues around the world and connected to those isolating elsewhere. This week, an example of our virtual programming is the virtual Leaders of the Americas Fellowship Program that empowers young entrepreneurs from Latin America and the Caribbean to launch new commercial and social ventures. To our fellows joining us today, welcome and thank you for joining. We are very excited to see the projects and businesses that you launch in your home countries. This past year, we hosted 35 online community events and even virtual world dinners, reaching over 4,000 in Colorado and beyond. Some highlights were hosting a former Secretary of Defense, a UN ambassador, a four-star general, and a former AP correspondent to South America, Africa. World Denver was a lifesaver for me when I found myself at home craving the global engagement I took for granted before having three kids. Instead of world travel with my family, international visitors would come to our home for a world dinner and American hospitality. We shared experiences around our dining room table, and it was a powerful and enriching experience for both our visitors and our kids. We also received some pretty incredible reciprocal invitations to visit and scuba dive in Mauritius, and a lifetime invitation to visit a family in China, to name just a few. If you are not yet a World Denver member, today is a great day to join. Get your global on and get to know us virtually until we can meet together in person. Our members consistently say that one of the greatest benefits of membership is meeting other global-minded members. Another way to support our work is by making a contribution to worlddenver.org. Now, on behalf of my fellow World Denver board, I'm pleased to introduce two women who embody leadership and advancement in national security, and who I have the pleasure of serving with on World Denver's board. Our International Women's Day event co-chairs are CU Denver Director of Global Education, Ambassador Catherine Ebert Gray, and Director of Advanced Programming at Lockheed Martin Space, Jamie Landers. Welcome, Catherine and Jamie.
Thank you for that warm welcome, Barrett. I am honored to serve as co-chair of World Denver's 9th annual International Women's Day celebration presented by Lockheed Martin. International Women's Day is recognized throughout the world as a day to celebrate the social, economic, cultural, and political achievements of women. The day also marks a call to action for accelerating equality and gender equity. Today's program specifically celebrates the women across the world working in peace and security. We will also focus on building the next generation of women leaders in public policy, foreign affairs, defense, and security. Now, to provide an overview of today's incredible program, I am pleased to introduce my co-chair, Ambassador Catherine Ebert Gray.
Thank you, Jamie. To our audience watching across Denver and around the world, prepare to be inspired by our lineup of talented and dedicated women serving our country and their communities across the spectrum of security fields. Our program begins with a top-flight panel of women who lead in national security, presented by CIGNA and led by Major General Barbara Falkenberry. Then we'll recognize our corporate honoree, Lockheed Martin, for their industry-leading commitment to the advancement of women in national security, as well as their long-standing support for the mission of World Denver. And we are proud to honor Metro State University President and former Undersecretary of the Navy, Dr. Janine Davidson, a true trailblazer for her leadership and service to our country and her impressive career in the fields of defense, security, and now higher education. Finally, our keynote conversation today will be between Ambassador Gina Abercrombie-Winstanley and Girl Security CEO Lauren Buitta. They're going to highlight the important work that's being done to create more effective representation in the fields of national peace and strategic strategy.
Thank you, Catherine. What an inspiring day we have ahead of us. And there's lots of opportunities for you to participate in today's event at home, including polls and questions and answers in the chat. We encourage you to take a selfie and share it with us using the hashtag WorldDenverIWD2021. And we want to see your celebration and share it with others. So let's kick it off with our first poll. We're dropping a link in the chat right now to a website called Mentimeter. And we're going to create a word cloud and show you the results later. Now keep an eye on that chat because we're going to have lots of different ways for you to engage in today's content and programming.
Before we begin, we'd like to take just a moment to thank our presenting sponsor, Lockheed Martin, our Medal of Honor panel sponsor, CIGNA, our Silver Star sponsors, Cardin Capital Partners, Raymond James, our Secure Future, and Dorsey and Whitney. And to all of our corporate sponsors, organizations, and individuals and their generous support, that's what made today possible. Thank you. And with that, our program begins with words of inspiration from the head of Colorado's National Guard, U.S. Army Brigadier General Laura Clellan, and Denver's Congresswoman Diana DeGette.
Hello, everyone. I'm Brigadier General Laura Clellan, the Adjutant General for Colorado. I'd like to thank World Denver for this International Women's Day event celebrating the achievements of women. In the U.S. military, gender integration has become a priority over the past 5 years. Women now work in many military jobs that were traditionally held by men, like aviation, infantry, armor, field artillery, and even special forces. These positions are open to women who qualify by completing the baseline standards and competencies. The military wants female service members assigned to positions that provide full and challenging careers and promotion opportunities. That's why we're taking a significant action to ensure promotion and selection boards are as fair and impartial as possible. The military is adding more female recruiters and attracting more women into combat leadership positions. The Department of Defense has been establishing policies that empower women to serve, such as expanding parental leave. The Colorado National Guard has a state partnership program with the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. Jordan and Colorado have had a 16-year partnership filled with trust, common challenges, and a deep understanding that's been built over time. As part of this partnership, we've conducted 7 women's leadership development exchanges between the Colorado National Guard and the Jordan Armed Forces Arab Army. Our exchanges have developed our women leaders and the junior and non-commissioned officers within our ranks. We feel the impact of this partnership every single day through developing our people and our capabilities. We have together increased our readiness. This enduring partnership is valuable on so many levels. In the Colorado National Guard, we're proud of the women who serve our state and nation with distinction. Under Governor Polis's leadership, we're working to promote equity, diversity, and inclusion. We've not yet achieved our goal of having women represented in all career fields, even though all military jobs are now open to anyone who qualifies. Communication, education, and mentorship are the key to removing barriers that prevent the full participation of women within our forces. Our nation will gain strength through a diverse volunteer force that represents all of the population we protect. Thank you for allowing me to address you in this special event.
Thank you for inviting me to participate in this wonderful event. And I want to give a special congratulations to Janine Davidson on this well-deserved recognition. As a distinguished U.S. Air Force pilot, former Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense, and now President of MSU, Janine's dedication to protecting our nation and bettering her community is second to none. I've proudly worked with Janine on a number of issues, and I can't think of a more perfect person to honor on this important day. International Women's Day is a day for countries and communities around the world to come together and uplift the achievements of women who have helped shape their societies. It's a day to celebrate the incredible ways in which women have made our world a better, stronger, and safer place to live. It's hard to think about the role women have played in shaping our approach to national security without also thinking of Denver's own Madeleine Albright, who once famously said that there was a great advantage in many ways to being a woman. We're better at personal relationships, and we have the ability to tell it like it is when necessary. Studies have shown that when societies empower women to fully participate in all aspects of life, they're more peaceful and prosperous as a result. Research also shows that when women participate in peace talks between nations, those negotiations are not only more likely to succeed, they're also more likely to result in lasting stability. So that's why it's so important that we ensure more women are serving in key positions across our government, and that they have a seat at the table when decisions about our nation's security are being made. Dr. Albright often said that she made women a central part of her foreign policy, not because she was a feminist, but because we know that societies are more stable if women are politically and economically empowered. She also once said, "There's a special place in hell for women who don't help other women." So events like today give us an opportunity not just to celebrate all that we've achieved, but also to empower one another to do more amazing things. So as we come together on this International Women's Day, let's not just celebrate our successes. Let's recommit ourselves to helping each other achieve even more.
Thank you. My name is Kasha Ivanichko-McLeod, Vice President of Community and Government Engagement for Cigna Mountain States. I'm proud to stand here virtually this year on behalf of Cigna and our local leadership supporting this very special event and panel of women. Cigna fosters a culture of belonging and equity that advances our mission to positively impact the well-being of the people and communities we serve. Cigna is a global health services company with a deep commitment to gender equity and the advancement of women within its leadership. Cigna is also a strong supporter of international exchange through sponsorship and through participation in meetings with professionals from around the world who receive critical guidance and expertise across the ever-changing healthcare spectrum. Today, we are proud to say that 69% of our workforce is female, and we have committed to continue to reach gender parity in our leadership talent pipeline by increasing the representation of women in senior roles from 45% to 50%. By 2024. This means that we will increase the number of women available to succeed to executive positions and support our goal of increasing representation of women in senior leadership. In fact, in February 2020, shortly before I stood on the stage with you in person, Cigna made two significant commitments. We became the first U.S.-based company in its industry to sign the United Nations Women Empowerment Principles, which are designed to empower women in the workplace, the marketplace, and the community. We also signed the Paradigm for Parity to hold ourselves accountable to setting measurable goals to increase the representation of women in Cigna leadership positions to ensure that the perspectives of women are included at all levels of the company. Championing a diverse and inclusive workforce improves our ability to innovate, create solutions that resonate with our customers, partners, and communities. Cigna is honored to be here today as the Medal of Honor sponsor for International Women's Day 2021. I've been given this tremendous privilege to introduce this phenomenal expert panel of women who lead in national security. In just a few short minutes, we will hear from women with decades of experience serving our country in defense, aerospace, intelligence, and even in the U.S. Congress. The panel will be led by a true titan in the national security field. Major General Barbara Falconberry is a graduate of the U.S. Air Force Academy. She has held leadership positions in Operations Southern Watch, Iraqi Freedom, Enduring Freedom, and she led as the Director of Mobility Forces for the U.S. Central Command during the drawdown of forces in Iraq. On top of her myriad of leadership roles and accomplishments, she's also a 12-time military racquetball champion. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Major General Barbara Falconberry.
Well, welcome to our intriguing panel on women in national security. Women certainly have been and are instrumental in our nation's protection, advancement, and reputation. And these four women joining us today have made an incredible impact in valuable areas throughout the security of our country. As they tell their stories, you're going to hear lessons in leadership and important perspectives on today's security issues. I'm retired Major General Barbara Falconberry and just thrilled to be here. I have the honor of hosting this panel. So let us begin. We have today with us Master Sergeant Heather Ruman. And Heather is currently serving 17 years in active duty and has had multiple combat experiences in our conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan. She has now been detailed to the U.S. Space Forces, and I really appreciate her being here today. Master Sergeant Ruman, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yes, hello. Can you hear me okay?
Absolutely.
All right, awesome. So first, I would like to say I'm just so honored to be here today speaking on this panel with this amazing group of women. I also want to start off by saying that anything that I say are the views of my own personal views, not the views of the United States Air Force or the Space Force. So with that said, I'm Master Sergeant Heather Ruman. I've been serving the Air Force for the last 7 years. I decided very early on in my high school career that I needed some direction and structure in my life, and I figured that the military helped with that. So at the young age of 17, 1 month after graduating high school, I enlisted into the United States Air Force as a security forces member. And what that basically is police in the Air Force. Within 6 months of joining, so I was 18, I was serving my first of three tours in Iraq. And by 2008, I was serving my third tour in Iraq, and quite frankly, I was burnt out. So in 2009, when I was pregnant with my firstborn, I decided to cross-train into a less operationally demanding career field, and that is the paralegal career field, which I am serving in now, and I have been for the last 11 years. I am married to an Army Special Forces soldier, Green Beret, and we have two daughters, 11 and 4. And I am now currently the superintendent of the best legal office in the Air Force, the Peterson Schriever Garrison legal team. And I'm happy to be here.
Thanks, Sergeant Ruman. Now, Kate Smith has had a very diverse career. She started at the academy in the military, went on to Notre Dame and a law degree. And this woman has never, ever been hesitant to make some noise and get in good trouble, necessary trouble, in the words of Representative John Lewis. Kate.
Thank you, classmate. I'm really happy to be here. Not only is Barb my classmate, we shared a tent in Jack's Valley. So we've known each other for 40 years. You know, as Barb says, I'm Catherine L. Smith, the daughter of Beverly Ann Smith, the granddaughter of Luberta Browning and the great-granddaughter of Isabel Johnson Hollis. And I come here today, you know, not as a lawyer, not as necessarily an Air Force veteran, but as a concerned citizen who's working to make sure that we have a better life for all our children and families. So thank you for inviting me to come. I'm really honored to be on this panel.
Thank you, Kate. I look forward to hearing more of your comments. General Susan Helms has reached and literally attained the stars. She retired as an Air Force three-star general and commanded all U.S. operational space forces. Susan is also one of a very small handful of people who have been to space five separate times. General Helms, over to you.
Thank you very much. I, too, am honored to be a part of this august group. I divide my life into basically three phases. I started out in eighth grade knowing I wanted to be in the Air Force like my dad. The path that I took was through the Air Force Academy, like a couple of the people in this group. I was actually 2 years ahead of Barb and Kate. And after I graduated from the Academy, my focus was to be an Air Force engineer, an aircraft Air Force engineer. I did that for about 10 years. And then I started the second phase of my life, which was to be lucky enough to be selected by NASA as an astronaut. And I spent 12 years at NASA from 1990 to 2002. My last space flight of those five that were mentioned was to the International Space Station. And I can't let this go without mention. I launched 20 years ago today with my crewmates on International Women's Day and was on the space station for almost 6 months. When I came back about a year later, I started the third phase of my life, which was to return to the Air Force after 12 years at NASA. And in the Air Force's great wisdom, they decided not to put me back in aircraft test, but to put me into the military space part of the Air Force. Today, all those organizations that I worked with for the next 12 years, those organizations are now all being consumed into the new Space Force. So I guess you could say I was in the precursor of the Space Force that people have heard about for today. So after 12 years, as was mentioned, I retired in one of my favorite jobs, which was to command all the Space Forces, and I've been retired for about 7 years since then. So thank you. I'm looking forward to the questions.
A pretty incredible career, I should say. U.S. Representative Alyssa Slotkin currently represents the very wise people of Michigan's 8th Congressional District. Congresswoman Slotkin has an amazing career of time in the CIA, the Department of State, the Department of Defense, and now the U.S. Congress. Talk about women in national security making it happen. Congresswoman Slotkin, over to you.
Thanks, Barb. Thanks for having me. And I am totally impressed with the women on this panel. It's not often that I go after someone who gets to say, like, the last time I was in space, et cetera, et cetera. So this is a great, amazing group, and happy International Women's Day to everybody. Indeed, as you said, I am a former CIA officer, and I decided to go into national security because of 9/11. And being in New York City on my second day of graduate school when 9/11 happened, and just changing my plans and feeling like national security was what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. From the CIA, I mean, as a lesson to so many young people, I was working on Iraq. We had, invaded 6 or 7 months beforehand. And within my first year at Langley, I was sent on my first of three tours in Iraq, working alongside the military. And in between those tours would, you know, come back to Washington and work in various national security roles. So I worked back at CIA. I worked for the first director of national intelligence. I had the opportunity to work at the State Department. And then I worked for the Bush White House. And I was there the last day that George Bush was in office and the first day that Barack Obama came in. So I got to see, frankly, how important it is to have a stand back, open-minded, objective approach to national security, how important leadership was. And I'm really looking forward to continuing to talk about all that today when we get to questions. So thanks for having me.
Thank you, Representative. You can see we're in for a fascinating panel today. So Sergeant Ruhlman, some of us have been in the military, but you're this generation's young people who have decided to join the military in a really tough time, I should say. And you've told us a little bit about your career in security forces, now in the legal field. Let's go back to when you were deployed in Operation Iraqi Freedom. Tell us a little bit about those experiences, and particularly of your leadership as a woman in a very male-dominated society.
Yes, ma'am. There was definitely a lot of unique challenges that I faced along the way. I think that 2021 military definitely looks a lot different than 2004 military did. In 2016, Secretary of Defense Ash Carter opened up all military occupations to women, like the general had said earlier. So women can now serve as, Green Berets, they can serve as Navy SEALs, they can serve in the infantry. And just the opportunities are endless for women in general. And while women were serving in combat at that time, it certainly was not as prevalent on the front lines. A unique challenge that I felt that I went through during my time in Iraq, more specifically, was in Balad in 2008. During that time, I was promoted on my squad, and my team of people were all men. I was the only female on my squad at the time. And so my peers went from being my subordinates, and that's just not unique to military. That's a difficult situation for anyone to be in. In addition to that, I was the only woman on the team. So on a mission one day, we were out, we went through a very stressful situation. It was a long ordeal, hours long ordeal. During that time, I showed some emotion. I didn't cry, I didn't freak out, but I allowed myself to show some vulnerability to a member on my team. The days and weeks following that incident, I was criticized and I was scrutinized for the emotions that I had showed during that time. I was made to feel like less of a leader, a weaker leader, for having showed any type of emotion during that event. I showed vulnerability, and at that time, that was, part of my leadership style. I say all this and I tell this story because I'm at a place in my life and in my career now where those are the exact traits that I would want in a leader. And I was made to feel like I had to be somebody that I was not. And I think we as women need to embrace our traits that make us special. And whether that's being sensitive or having a bleeding heart or being an empath, I think we need to do that. And this is just one of the many unique challenges that I feel like I faced along the way, but it's certainly one I'll never forget because it has helped me define what leadership means to me and what I want in the characteristics of a leader.
You know, Heather, it strikes me that everyone knows Brené Brown, and now Brené is being asked to talk to senior U.S. military leaders just for this reason, because those are the best leadership attributes for a leader that people will follow into combat. So Heather, you've got so many demands. You've told us about, being married to another military member. You've got two little girls. How tough is that? Has that been? And what would you tell your girls if they say, Mom, I want to join the military? What do you say?
So yeah, it can be extremely tough at times. I think that I'm always trying to find the balance between sacrifice and compromise, recognizing that I am probably sacrificing to get to the compromise. And, what I would tell my daughters or any young woman who wants to join the military, or as they start planning their life or their career plan, is that there are stigmas and expectations that are put on us as women. I don't know whether that's our society or something that just we put on ourselves in general. There is a quote that I saw. I don't know who said it, so I apologize. But it's one of my favorites. And it's, women are expected to work like they don't have children and raise children as if they don't work. That resonates with me a lot in my life because, you know, nothing worth it comes easy. We have to work hard for everything we have, and I teach my daughters that. And I certainly would never dissuade them for wanting to join the military or any career path for that matter, because the military has given me everything that I have in my life. Obviously, it was not without hard work, but all the opportunities that I have been given is because the Air Force has given them to me. And I certainly would not dissuade them, like I said, because now women are breaking barriers and there are so many opportunities within the military for women.
Thank you very much. Kate, you and I started out together a few years ago, as you said, but you, after your military time, you became a corporate lawyer, and then you went into community policing and collaboration, and now I've seen you up on Capitol Hill influencing Congress on security issues. Wow. So what was it about that military start that got you to those different steps to, in fact, even sway Congress on issues? What was it?
You know, thank you, Barb. When I introduced myself, I introduced my mother, my grandmother, and my great-grandmother, who inspire me to this day. And we've always in my family had a commitment to service. And I tell people, attending the United States Air Force Academy was the best mistake of my life. I was not that military, you know, good cadet, but it laid the foundation for everything I've done after that. I didn't know how to swim when I went to the academy. After 56 lessons, I achieved that minimum. It taught me never to give up. It taught me to believe in myself. Notre Dame Law School was easy after surviving the Air Force Academy. And so I think the military gave me the credibility behind my voice. I was just a small town kid from Atchison, Kansas, and nobody expected a whole lot from me. And I had the opportunity to go to the Air Force Academy. I graduated as one of the first 10 black women to graduate from the academy. That gives you a certain confidence so that you can stand up and do a press conference in the shadow of the Capitol.
Well, Kate, and I should say she is a fantastic storyteller. If you ever want someone to entertain you, bring Kate into the audience. But turning to a really serious topic, Kate, the January 6th attack on Congress by the rioters unfortunately had a number of military members, retired military members, in that group. Can you talk about that? It's deeply disturbing to me. And in these recent polarization times, how does the military react in this kind of conflict?
I'm gonna correct you. I wouldn't call them rioters. I would call them insurrectionists. We swore an oath to the Constitution, and we believe in our democracy. And when I heard that one of the people that was arrested that day also graduated from our academy, I was shocked and dismayed. And I think what happens is, as military members, we have a need to belong. And so I think, and I'm really proud of the Secretary of Defense that he's going to do a stand down to understand why military members are radicalized and have extremist views, to understand why someone who swore an oath to the Constitution would engage in such behavior. And I don't claim to know the answer, but I think it's a symptom in this country where we don't come together for the good of everybody. And it's sad when I saw and watched it on television, You know, it was, I was terrified for my friends that work on the Hill, and saddened by the number of military members, former military members that were involved.
Thank you. General Helms, you are part of a really exclusive group. There's only been 342 NASA astronauts, and only 48 of them have been women. Of the 342 astronauts, there have been 80 Air Force officers in that. And then interestingly, only about 10 of those came back into the Air Force as you were talking about it. Can you talk about that return and then perhaps the leadership attributes that propelled you to 3-star rank in the U.S. military?
Yes, thank you. Actually, my return back to the Air Force started in eighth grade when I was committing my life to working for the Air Force and part of the Air Force. And so to me, in my head, when I went to NASA, it was with the sense that this was a temporary thing I would do and then I would come back to the Air Force. And I never lost that goal. So for me, it was a natural act after so many years and so many space flights to then start asking the questions, okay, I've done this, I'm ready to come back to the Air Force and give back to the Air Force, how do I do that? And that happened in about 2002 with the help of some very insightful Air Force leaders at the time who knew what to do with me and where to place me that would be most helpful to the Air Force, which is now, by the way, as I said, the Space Force. As far as the leadership qualities, there's a lot of them that I can come up with, but I think there's four I would like to name. The first is the quality of integrity. When you're a leader, you have to have a North Star. You have to have something that guides your character, which, by the way, is fairly easy to do when the times are good, but when you are in desperate need of that North Star is when times don't go so well. And so leaning on integrity as a leader is, I would say, kind of a no-fail approach for helping you make decisions you haven't been trained to decide and trying to do them in the best way possible. The second quality I would bring out is confidence. I had a little bit of an edge there. I came back to the Air Force and got put in the space business, and because I had been a satellite, I came in with a level of confidence about the space world that a lot of people in the Air Force didn't have. But it is very important not to be questioned about your confidence, that you know what you're talking about, that you understand what your mission is, that you have the ability to lead from the front from a confidence standpoint. The third is the service before self. You are there as a senior leader in the military to make important decisions that are delegated to you from on high, but it's also on making those decisions in the context of taking care of your people and dedicating yourself so that the Air Force mission is superior to what your own personal interests might be. And I think this speaks very well to what Kate just described in terms of some of the things that the military is grappling with now. Service before self, for me, would dictate that that is that's pointing only in a certain direction in terms of people's behavior in the, under these circumstances. And then the fourth one is speaking truth to power. I did that a lot. Some days I was the bird, and some days I was the windshield. But I felt like that was a very important characteristic of a leader who is not afraid to put things out there, because oftentimes it's only the leader who can do it. And being able to speak to a number of different levels, speaking truth to power, however that might be required through any given scenario, that was something a leader can't sit back around what's comfortable. If in fact you see things that must, and you have to say something about it. I think that's a very important quality. So with that, Barb, I'll wrap up, but that was my short list that I could talk to from a very long list.
Well, those are great lessons in leadership for everyone in every profession, for sure. General Helms, the Outer Space Treaty is not quite the space is a peaceful place treaty that we would hope it would be necessarily. It really just prohibits placing nuclear weapons in space and then limits celestial bodies to simply peaceful purposes. Now, that said, there's been four countries, the United States, India, China, and Russia, that have conducted an anti-satellite exercise, shot down one of their own satellites to perhaps prove they have that capability. Can you talk about, now that space is integral to every single person's career, whether or life, and from the youngest person to the oldest person, every day we're using space assets. How is the United States protecting ourselves in space, and that perhaps that terrible day when a hostile nation may try to impact our space assets?
Yes, thank you very much for that question. I'll back up and mention a couple of facts about what's going on in space right now. Early on, 50 years or so ago, it was only a couple of very rich countries, namely the United States and the Soviet Union, who had the assets and resources to actually send satellites into space. And now it's well over 50, 60 countries that have the ability to do that. And space has become a domain that is not of governments, but is of commerce. 80% of the satellites, give or take, are now being used for commercial purposes, scientific purposes, and soon to be tourism purposes. And so it's really not a governmental domain anymore. It is now an extension of humanity, doing the things that humans do in society. So along with the nature of humanity comes the nature of mischief. And in those examples you mentioned, those are demonstrated examples of deliberate mischief, where there have been some nation states that have shown the rest of the world they have the ability to execute or prosecute some sort of attack. And they'd like to have the world know that so it can be used as a deterrent for national objectives. And when knowing that this is now part of the reality of humanity moving to the space domain, along with humanity moving to the space domain comes a need to move the defense of the space domain for the sake of humanity, and not so much for the militaries, but for the commerce that's happening up there that drives the economies around the world. And so in the United States, the Space Force has been stood up to put focus and resources on this question of how do you now get to your nation to the point where you have a defense ability for the mischief that could happen in space in the event it does happen. And I'm certainly not saying it will happen. But nonetheless, it's always been the United States' national objective to be prepared, like any good Girl Scout. And the advent of the Space Force will definitely provide political and national will to help us do that, just in case mischief decides to manifest itself in the space domain, which has fairly horrific implications if, in fact, a battlefield were to happen in the space domain.
Yeah, that'd be frightening indeed. Representative Slotkin, the diversity and breadth of your experience in national security has got to be unmatched in all of government. Intelligence community, state, defense, Congress now. Wow. Can you talk about those steps and how each one prepared you for the next? And then with perhaps this audience in mind, what would be your words to women thinking about security serving in that area?
Sure. I mean, I think the most important thing, and the other panelists have made really great comments about leadership, is, you know, I don't think anyone wakes up and says, okay, here's how I'm going to plot my career. I'm going to do this in a year and this in 3 years and this in 2 years. Or maybe they have a plan and doesn't survive first contact. I think the thing that propels you on to the next opportunity is, one, truly being the master of your portfolio, you know, really drilling down and being as sharp as anyone on the issue you cover, and Then secondly, seizing opportunities when they come. And in that vein, I think, you know, one of the lessons that I always, you know, recommend to people I'm mentoring is you don't ask, you don't get. You know, no one cares as much about your career as you do. So sometimes you have to ask for those opportunities, frankly, particularly if you're a woman in the national security world. And the number of times where I've sort of sat there and hemmed and hawed and said, I really want to go and work for, you know, the new director of national intelligence. I'm briefing him every day. I don't know if it would be presumptuous to ask and to offer. And finally, I worked up the courage and said, sir, if you ever need someone to work, you know, for you in your new capacity. And he said, great, we leave Tuesday, right? So if I had never asked that question, I would have never moved on to that next step. So you don't ask, you don't get is a big lesson for me. And then frankly, I think for women in general as well, you really have to push on, decision makers to see women as not just a great staffer behind the scenes, not just a great military assistant or chief of staff or someone who makes the trains run on time, but actually the boss. And you have to be pushing constantly for the opportunity to be the boss. And sometimes that takes shaking up some expectations and asking again to be considered for the boss. And then lastly, Lord, from my experience of going from national security person to a congressperson, you know, I was talking to a couple of colleagues. I'm like, I don't know if I can really make this leap. This is a very different world. You know, it seems like a crazy thing to do. And this friend said, you know what? I'm convinced that in the United States, fortune favors the bold. If you are bold and you're willing to do something that someone else or many people are not willing to do, and you succeed at it and you're smart about it, you can have, you know, real rewards and real opportunities. And so the times in my life where I've said, okay, let's just, you know, roll the dice and try, have worked out because there's so many people who were worried about taking that risk. So those are a few things that have certainly helped me move through the system a bit.
Those are great issues. And I love your phrase, if you don't ask, you don't get. I would say that starting as an intern with the CIA, State Department, Defense are awesome opportunities for young people. We need to go to some questions now. And I know there's like 1,000 questions out there, but I think we've got 4. So let's start with that first one.
Linda Collins Arsenault. I was the founder of Women Powering Change. And I have a question for the whole panel. So the Women, Peace and Security Act of 2017 was passed in the House and Senate and signed by President Trump, a bipartisan effort, mandates that the U.S. play a global role in promoting women's leadership and participation in peace and security. So assuming that we can reach gender parity in this area, what changes would you anticipate in seeing in national security?
Cinda, that's a great question. Let me ask General Helms to answer that.
Thank you. That is a great question. When I think about the military profession, I think about an extremely disciplined yet somewhat narrowly focused profession on defending our country and our allies. And I have personally had some experiences where I've been with decision makers in a room, and one of the unfortunate side effects of having a fairly narrow profession is that that profession can become subject to groupthink, which means that almost everybody in the room thinks the same way, they ponder over problems, they come up with the same solutions, but it doesn't necessarily do full justice to all of the options that you might want to put forward as military advice to your national leadership. My other experiences have told me that when you raise gender parity, it just happens naturally that you get diversity of thought when you are pondering over these types of majorly strategic decisions. And so I would anticipate that with gender parity, as we get closer and closer to that perfect world, and long before we get there, there will be something about having diversity of thought in the room on these very weighty and strategic decisions that take place among military leadership that could do nothing but improve the quality of the outcomes related to those decision-making processes.
All right, I think we have another question.
So my question is, what is need to be done so we people of color can feel safe in our own country?
So safe in our own country. Kate, this is the 21st century. What do you think?
And I'd like to thank the audience member for asking that question. You know, racism is the greatest pandemic of our nation. And it's up to white people to solve racism. In the meantime, I think there are probably three things that we can do to help people of color be safer in our own communities. First, let's demilitarize the police. There's no reason that we need an MRAP running down the streets of Colfax Avenue, military mine-resistant armored personnel carrier. There's no reason for that. There's no reason for the police to have the same weapons that the sergeant used in Afghanistan or Iraq. I think we also need to end qualified immunity. And I might need to talk to the representative about that issue the next time I'm on the Hill. But there's no reason for the police to automatically not be charged when they commit murder on a private citizen. And I also think that we need to reformulate how we think of policing. There's no reason to send an armed police officer to assist a person with a mental health crisis on the street. And part of the work I've done in the past is also teaching the police how to de-escalate situations. And I think those are the issues. But I also think it is really incumbent upon white people to be not innocent bystanders, not to just stop being actively racist. You have to start becoming actively anti-racist. You have to be an ally and speak out and use your voice when you see instances of injustice. Thank you for asking that question.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more, or two more maybe.
Hi, I'm Laura, and I work in communications in the space industry. And my question is for all the panelists, knowing that you have such high pressure jobs, how do you make sure that you take care of yourself?
So all of these panelists are feeling that high pressure, but Sergeant Ruhlman, how about if you answer that?
Yes, ma'am, that's a great question. And I think that it's probably a question that we all hope to be able to answer and say, oh yeah, I always take really good care of myself. Self-care is most important. But you know, nowadays, what is self-care? I think that probably looks different for everybody. For me, is going to look a lot different than it is for you. But what I focus on with my leadership style and in my office and with my team is really not just focusing on maybe your physical health, but your emotional health and mental health. I'm trying to really remove that stigma behind mental health and in receiving mental health care. So kind of a goal for me this year has been going and talking to somebody, whether that's my friend or going to a counselor, and just getting right up here, you know, and because you can't fill from an empty cup. I take it upon myself to be there for everybody else, but I can't be someone's rock if I am not solid in my foundation and in myself. And with that, I can't, you know, be a good mom or I can't be a good wife for my family. So really just focusing on my mental health and knowing that I need to take that time for just me and talking through some things with people.
I think we'd all like you as our leader. Last question.
National security is a broad field, and many of you have worked in multiple industries. So my question today is, as you transition from one industry to another, how has that affected your career in national security? Thank you.
Representative Slotkin, you are like the expert on this. What do you say?
I think the things that make you successful in one section of your career are the things that are going to be successful for you in the next one. And so, you know, there are some basics to leadership, learning how to manage people, frankly, learning how to manage money, learning how to help others achieve what they want to achieve. Those are transferable skills. So for me, it's about taking the universals from each part of, you know, whatever job you're in and going to the next person, the next opportunity and saying, hey, here are the five things that I learned how to do with real depth, and I can bring that to your organization or your business. I think that I will take a smart, capable person who's not a subject matter expert any day over a mediocre subject matter expert. So making sure that you're showing whoever that new employer is just what you're particularly good at, those universal things, I think will always serve you well.
Thank you, Representative. And I feel good about the members of Congress leading us with you you there. What a great conversation. There's 1,000 people here that want to say thank you to this panel. And it's just been awesome. So thank you for being with us today. And as we conclude, we have a special video for you on the Women, Peace, and Security Act.
Our Secure Future works to strengthen the Women, Peace, and Security agenda to build a more peaceful world. Involving women from all parts of society and at all levels is not only a human right, but it leads to better security outcomes across all issues. We're thrilled to support this year's theme of Women in International Security. Thanks for watching our explainer video.
What happens when security only considers half of the population? Put simply, it just doesn't work. Women are 73% more likely than men to die in a car crash. Because these are the tests we count on to protect us. That same logic applies to entire societies. They work better when women actively participate in their design. This agenda is called Women, Peace, and Security, and it comes directly from women in the Global South who know the formula for a more secure world. The United Nations endorsed it for the first time in 2000. Because they understand that states with a larger gender gap see more corruption, disease, and violence. In societies where women are full and equal participants, we see stronger economies, healthier children, and more peace. The concept is simple. Everyone benefits when women are included at all levels of decision making. As lawmakers,
walls come down.
As thought leaders,
to move this issue forward.
As peacemakers, and as equal social and economic partners.
So this is really good because it allows government to do gender assessment.
The agenda impacts women, but it also impacts the security of our entire world. Peace accords that exclude women fail 50% of the time. In turn, countries led by women fare much better in global pandemics. Women expand the definition of what makes us secure. And in 2017, the U.S. Congress agreed, passing a law mandating women's roles in advancing security.
The Women, Peace, and Security Act.
Now women must be included in defense, diplomacy, and development decision-making to promote peace.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Now our foreign policy professionals must look at problems from a different perspective. Women, Peace, and Security shows us how. At every conference, in every program, in each policy, we must ask ourselves this. Who is making the decisions? Who is left out? What are they saying? And how do we include them? Women, Peace, and Security asks us to examine our world differently, whether we're testing cars or forging treaties. And if we do that, we are all more secure.
I am so proud of our Congress for passing the Women in Peace and Security Act, and I hope you'll all support us in implementing that around the world. And let me just take a minute to say how incredibly impressed I was with that panel, and thank you, General Falkenberry, for that. You're the kind of gals I want to hike a 49er with. I'd like to take a minute now to recognize the classrooms, the teachers, and all the students that are tuning in today, especially Lakewood High School, Kent, Denver, and Girl Scouts of Colorado. And I'd like to thank those of you that sponsored these classrooms to allow them to join us. You know, each year, World Denver recognizes International Women's Day honorees for outstanding achievements in the theme of each year and their exceptional commitment to World Denver's mission. Joining us virtually today is Colorado Governor Jared Polis and Denver Mayor Michael Hancock to present these awards. Thank you for joining us.
I'm thrilled to join World Denver in the 9th annual celebration of International Women's Day. As our state continues to grow and emerge as an epicenter for international business, trade, higher education, and cultural exchange, I thank World Denver and their membership for keeping our state connected to the entire world. World Denver's exchange programs, now being conducted virtually, have facilitated real conversations between Colorado business leaders, lawmakers, educators, public servants, and their counterparts all over the world. We have a lot to learn from one another. I'm also honored to recognize today's corporate honoree, Lockheed Martin, for their commitment to the advancement of women in the national security industry. As one of the world's leading aerospace and defense companies, Lockheed Martin has a long history of supporting women in science, technology, engineering, and math careers. The organization prioritizes engagement of employee resource groups like the Women's Impact Network and partnerships with organizations like the Society of Women Engineers, Girls Inc., and many more. With these activities, Lockheed Martin creates real opportunities for women in the workforce and continues to inspire the next generation of female engineers and scientists. Through providing a pipeline for female leadership on our most daring missions, from exploring the outer reaches of space to keeping us safe here on Earth, Lockheed Martin continues to be a driving force for gender equity in national security and defense. And we're thrilled to honor them today. Here to accept the International Women's Day Corporate Award on behalf of Lockheed Martin is Kay Sears, Vice President and General Manager of Lockheed Martin Space's Military Space Line of Business. Congratulations to Lockheed Martin.
Satellites that will help make secure, tougher to jam and spoof M-code signals available to our military forces around the world.
Sector, this is Ronet. We are in position on scene and navigating to a ship's distress signal. Stand by for medevac.
The State Department has stated hackers tried to attack U.S. satellites today, but failed due to artificial intelligence that actively defends and heals from cyber attacks.
We have the target baited. Be advised, we are taking small arms fire.
Our why inspires us to protect, connect, and explore today and for generations to come.
Thank
Thank you, Governor Polis. And thank you to World Denver for honoring Lockheed Martin with this award as we come together to celebrate International Women's Day. As the governor mentioned, I am Kay Sears, Vice President and General Manager of Military Space at Lockheed Martin. I lead the teams that build and deliver critical national security space capabilities and that protect our nation and troops around the world. Many of these systems also have commercial and public benefits, like GPS. The fact that Lockheed Martin is being honored today for lifting up women in national security means a lot to me as a female leader working in national security. I know we're making great strides to help close the gender gap, but it still exists, and there is still much work to be done. It also means a lot to me that this whole program today focuses on building the next generation of women in peace and security and includes a panel of women who lead in national security. We at Lockheed Martin work to promote women in national security roles in a variety of ways. We support multiple programs with girl-focused STEM outreach, where we provide role models to inspire young girls to pursue STEM fields. Our internal Women's Impact Network helps us connect, support each other in our careers, and find opportunities for growth. And we offer great job flexibility, including job sharing, alternative work locations or telecommuting, and creative work schedules with 540, 980, or 410 work weeks. And we provide additional benefits during COVID, called backup care, to help employees balance personal responsibilities to relieve some of the burden that has been disproportionately placed on working women throughout the pandemic to care for sick family members or children who are out of school. But we're just one company in this industry. Having World Denver host today's event with so many incredible women representing the national security industry helps to highlight new possibilities to those who might not have considered this rewarding and important career path. This event celebrates so many women's achievements in national security, and I hope that hearing their stories on this public stage provides a glimpse into the work that has already been done and the bright future that more women can be a part of by joining us. Lockheed Martin supported World Denver's mission and programs since before its founding, when programs were part of the International Institute of Education. Our support has included corporate membership, event sponsorship, and strong participation in your international exchange programs. Throughout our 9-year history, Lockheed Martin has hosted countless meetings facilitated by World Denver with leaders from around the globe in security, tech, and the aerospace fields. As an example, just last fall, Lockheed Martin participated in one of the first ever virtual exchanges with government and aerospace industry leaders from France to discuss emerging opportunities around public-private partnerships. We also had the privilege to host meetings where we virtually met with partnerships in the U.S. aerospace sector in October of 2020. We met with U.S.-India Space Cooperation in May of 2018. We met with National Security in the Space Domains in May of 2016. And we met with Expanding Communication and Media Access Group in October of 2013. We are proud to partner with World Denver in support of their mission to strengthen and expand the community of engaged global citizens and organizations in Colorado. I hope those of you who attended or participated in this event today continue to support this great organization and further their work to benefit communities across the globe. On behalf of Lockheed Martin, thank you again for this wonderful recognition. We will continue to do what we can to promote women in national security roles. And I hope that I can count on you, all of you, to do the same in your organizations and communities. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Mayor Michael Hancock here. I am honored to join World Denver today in their 9th annual celebration of International Women's Day. Thank you, World Denver, for all your efforts to keep our city connected globally. We are all looking forward to the day, hopefully very soon, when we can once again safely welcome international students, business, and civic leaders to our great city. And now, it is my distinct honor to present today's individual honor to MSU Denver President and former Undersecretary of the Navy and my good friend, Janine Davidson. Dr. Davidson's career as a leader in defense, national security, and now higher education exemplifies the trailblazing spirit that we celebrate today. At MSU Denver, Dr. Davison oversees the third largest university in Colorado and educates the most students of color and the most first-generation students in the state. The university has high-quality, innovative programs like aviation, engineering, cybersecurity, and teaching that transform Denver into a better place to live. Dr. Davison has been a great partner for the city, leading MSU Denver's efforts to help with the U.S. Census, get out the vote efforts, and now vaccine distribution efforts. She is a strong civic leader and a great ambassador for our city, and I couldn't be prouder to celebrate her today. Congratulations, my dear friend.
Well, thank you, Mayor Hancock, for that kind introduction. I appreciate your leadership of our city and your continued support for MSU Denver. I remember hearing you telling an audience once how you first decided to become a feminist, and it was when you heard the doctor say, "It's a girl," and I love you for that. Thank you, World Denver, for hosting this great event to celebrate International Women's Day. I am grateful to be here today with all of these accomplished and aspiring women. And what about that panel? What amazing women leaders. I am so thrilled to be in acquaintance with them. Well done. I am truly honored to receive this award today. World Denver's mission to strengthen and expand the community of engaged global citizens resonates so deeply with me, so thank you sincerely for all that you do. But to be honest, getting honored in this way is always a bit bewildering. It seems to me that just about everything of note that I have accomplished in my life has a lot to do with luck and timing, you know, sort of the right place at the right time sort of thing. And the rest is definitely a team sport. So I will accept this honor on behalf of so many others who came before me and in gratitude to so many more who have been with me along on the journey. For me, it is about those who encouraged and mentored me and who worked with me and for me. My gratitude goes to my enormous and supportive extended family, and my father in particular, who encouraged me to work hard and to not shy away from leading for as long as I can remember. My husband Dave, of course, who also makes me laugh and think, and thankfully cooks a hell of a lot better than I do. And to my really great bosses and mentors, like General Darren McDew, Richard Dancing, Dr. Kath Hicks, and Michelle Flournoy, who taught me so many tricks of the trade. And since it's International Women's Day, I'd like to call out these two remarkable women in national security, Michelle Flournoy and Kath Hicks, who have made an immense impact on me and on so many others. Having started my career in uniform and then transitioned to civilian life, I had literally never had a woman boss or a mentor. And as a Deputy Assistant Secretary in the Pentagon, Kath and Michelle were my immediate chain of command. This was the beginning of the Obama administration, and I had never realized how many amazing women were already leading in national security at super senior levels. But they were all on the civilian side, or mostly. So while women had been serving in uniform for a very long time, it was really only since the 1990s that so many important combat roles had been opened to women. This included fighter planes in 1993 and then combat ships in 1994. And it was not until the 2000s that submarines and infantry jobs opened to women. So as many senior Pentagon civilians in 2009, most of our counterparts, the admirals and generals, were still men. And it was not unusual, except for Susan Helms and Barb Falkenberry, who I often worked with, but it was not unusual for me to be in a meeting and note that all the senior civilians on the Deputy Assistant Secretary side were women at the table, while all the admirals and generals on the other side were men, with often Michelle or Kath sitting at the head of the table. And this steady march of women in national security, who in turn keep mentoring more generations, has had an incredible difference. It is no accident that President Biden's Pentagon landing team included 13 women and 9 men and was run by a woman, Kath Hicks, who is now the first woman Deputy Secretary of Defense. Meanwhile, on the uniform side, women have been catching up. The last few years have included even more firsts, and here are a few just to celebrate. In December 2020, just less than 3 months ago, the Navy announced the first woman to command an aircraft carrier. And last summer, we saw the first African-American woman become a Navy tactical pilot. And now it seems like that kind of took a long time, given that the first white woman to become a fighter pilot, Jeannie Flynn, now Jeannie Levitt, flew a fighter plane nearly 27 years ago. African-American men and women are still woefully underrepresented in the military's leadership ranks, civilian and uniform. And although the first woman to make the rank of four-star admiral in the Navy was African-American, that was Michelle Howard, who when she pinned on her four stars, the Pentagon's uniform shop had to special order the four-star shoulder boards because they did not make them for women yet in 2014. So the point is, although we have seen many barriers break in the past 30 years, we are definitely not finished yet. Women comprise just 7% of the 48,300 active duty National Guard and reserve pilots now serving in the military. And of those 3,000 female pilots, only 72 identify as African American or Black. Meanwhile, the arc of progress for LGBTQ Americans has not been quite as linear. From the weird don't ask, don't tell of the Clinton-era rule, rescinded in 2011 by President Obama, to the stop and start transgender rules that we've seen in the last few years. What we are finally realizing is that just breaking down the legal barriers to open more and more seats to underrepresented people is hard, but it is also not actually enough. From 2017 to 2020, I had the honor of serving on the National Commission for Military, National, and Public Service. And we had two primary charges. Number one, now that all restrictions of women in the military had been lifted, should they also not be required to register for the Selective Service? And number two, we were charged with finding ways to inspire more Americans to serve in all kinds of public service, civilian and military. We published a report just 1 year ago with our highly controversial recommendation that young women should, in fact, register for the Selective Service, the same as young men. And the law has yet to be readdressed. In our research, we discovered overwhelming agreement among the younger generations, men and women, that women should register. In fact, when we met with college and high school students, most of them were amazed, perplexed, and sometimes actually ticked off to learn that women were not required to register. Although also, too many young Americans did not even know what the Selective Service was, which was another issue altogether. What many of them had heard, though, were the stories of sexual assault and sexual harassment in the military. And that seemed to be a growing deterrent for many women considering military service. Now, this is something that my generation did not anticipate. We just wanted a seat at the table, or on the bridge, or in the cockpit. We stood on the shoulders of our mothers and our grandmothers, who, as Gloria Steinem once said, are old enough to remember when things were actually worse. And we fought the battles of our day so that today's generation would have no legal restrictions from service. But now, as leaders, we need to keep fighting to make sure the next generation has everything they need to soar. We have to keep working to change the culture, the command climate, if you will, the attitudes, so that we can continue to unlock the power of diversity in our ranks. And as a former Navy undersecretary, and now as a president of a large, diverse university, I can tell you that this generation is ready. From the deck plates of Navy ships on the Pacific Ocean to the classrooms at MSU Denver, I have heard this generation speak to its vision, their dreams for equality and inclusion. This generation is fierce, and they are bold. They embrace diversity, and they demand inclusion and equity. And they will not put up with the stuff we put up with. And you know, they shouldn't have to. And as our friend Gloria Steinem also wisely observed, we need to remember across generations, there is so much to learn as there is to teach. So I charge you all to keep on listening and learning in order to lead. Do not be discouraged by the day-to-day fight. We have come a very, very long way, and the next generation is ready. So thank you again to World Denver and to all of you who are stopping to reflect on today, on all we have accomplished and all we have yet to do on this 2021 International Women's Day. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Hancock and Governor Polis, and congratulations to our honorees. Now, earlier in the program, we asked you to respond to a question. What words come to mind when you think of women's empowerment? We're going to take a second and look at that word cloud now. And if you're unfamiliar with word clouds, the words get larger the more often that they are mentioned. And so I'll take a moment to comment on some of those words that we see and pop out. And they seem to be ongoing themes that we've heard throughout our program today. Strength and strong. All the women that you heard on the panel today, and President Davidson and Kay Sears, all talked about the strength that they've gathered from their support networks throughout their careers. Support is another word that we see in there. Supporting our communities, supporting each other, supporting other diverse groups who also need advocacy. Equity, gender parity, making sure that women not only have a seat at the table or at the cockpit, like President Davidson said, but making sure that we have a sense of belonging and that our words are heard, understood, and then used to create action. That sense of belonging becomes really important because it's not just about parity, but it's making sure you can feel like you can speak up. And then the last one I see that pops out is intersectionality, which is great because all of these words really do intersect. And national security is a broad and a diverse field. Women are increasingly taking leadership roles every day in peacekeeping, diplomacy, cybersecurity, aerospace, climate science, migration, food security, and so many other careers that keep our country and our planet safe. Over the last few months, World Denver has collected short videos from women working in security fields across the globe, and we're very excited to present some of those videos to you today. Four of these women will join me for a discussion on forging new paths in national security on March 18th, presented by Lockheed Martin and World Denver Young Professionals. Register for that discussion and all of World Denver's events on worlddenver.org. Now with that, let's enjoy some unique and engaging perspectives from around the world of women in national security.
Investing in a pipeline for women to serve our country in national security is an investment in diversity of thought, diversity of perspective. I've been in the workplace for 30 years, and I've seen how women's work roles have grown and expanded. I've seen women change and increase the strength of the workplace, which is why the diversity is so essential.
We are redefining what makes us secure. Do we need things such as healthcare, education, homes, and jobs? Or do we need more weapons of mass destruction? That's why it's so critical for women to be involved in this field of national security.
I love being a scientist in the national security domain because of all the fascinating, challenging, unique problems that we have to work on. And I love working with teams of people from diverse backgrounds and experiences to come up with solutions to really make a difference in people's lives.
I got my master's in security studies. I have had remarkable mentors. I spent 10 years running an organization that worked with U.S. militaries around the world in Afghanistan, Iraq, Somalia. And then I was at the Pentagon advising the chairman of the Joint Chiefs on human rights. Usually the only woman in the room. I am all for more women getting into national security. You can do so much in this field, things that you care about, things that make a difference in the world.
I work with a lot of different types of technologies. Some of these technologies are opportunities for national security. Other technologies are threats we have to defend against. Both perspectives are important for keeping our nation safe.
Women everywhere are inspired by seeing a woman in a position where they've never seen one before, and that's what we need to do all across professions to make sure that women can see the position and they can dream about it in the future. We've done that here at the fire department and certainly hope everybody does that all across the national security spectrum.
The field of forensics is increasingly becoming female dominated, with over 60% of the field being female. It is my honor as a woman in the field of forensics to step up and be a leader when I am called upon, and I challenge each of you to do the same.
Working in a range of government agencies on space and cybersecurity has been a fascinating experience for me. We are reliant on our use of both space capabilities and the internet, but vulnerable to threats and attacks. Over the course of my career, I've been lucky to have had strong female mentors, some of whom are participating in this event.
Meaningfully including women is not just the right thing to do, it's the smart thing to do. Women are needed everywhere conversations and decisions about peace and security are being made. This includes conflict prevention and resolution, disaster and humanitarian response, peacekeeping and post-conflict recovery. So on behalf of the entire U.S. Indo-Pacific Command team, it is my pleasure to wish you all a happy International Women's Day.
Today we celebrate a national imperative. As half of the world's population, women play a critical role in achieving lasting security and peace. The security landscape is transforming, and we need the innovation and smart ideas of all women to continue this evolution.
So great progress, but let's keep going, especially when we're dealing with the existential challenge of nuclear weapons. We need the best and the brightest, and that means all the women we can get. Thank you.
You can achieve your goals with the determination. The first woman, Chief of Defense of the Slovenian Forces, was appointed in 2018. Contingent commanders, defense attachés, and others. Me, I was the first woman sports director in the International Military Sports Council back in 2009. Above all, what matters is inclusion in peace and security.
Terrorism continues to pose one of the biggest security challenges to the national security of India. I believe in undertaking systematic research and evaluation to support the policymakers, while also ensuring to bring together all the stakeholders, especially women, in designing and implementing comprehensive counterterrorism strategies aimed at preserving security for all.
It's my hope and my colleagues' hope that on this International Women's Day and on the other 364 days a year, we can continue to shift the burden away from women having to make the case for their own inclusion and place the burden on our institutions and organizations to accurately identify the barriers that women and gender diverse people face and to systematically remove them. We're doing it at home, where we still struggle ourselves. We're delighted to be working with colleagues in the US and around the world to help us all advance globally. And we look forward to getting some great insights from your discussions today.
I believe that we need to create a pipeline for young women to pursue careers in this field. And that's because we need a diverse set of voices. I was frequently the only woman in a room full of men who were making major national security decisions that would impact millions of Americans. And my voice was frequently drowned out. So we need to find ways to encourage young women to pursue careers in this field so that we have better representation at the decision-making table.
Today, it's an existential imperative that women claim their seat at the table and lead the way to abolish nuclear weapons. We can do this, and we must, for our children, for our future. We don't have a moment to spare.
Women continue to be underrepresented in all decision-making processes related to international security. Rectifying that imbalance is critical to the goal of achieving full and equal participation of women. But we have to own that goal for ourselves. With that in mind, I encourage you all, dare to believe, dare to fail, dare to succeed. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm John Krieger, Executive Director of World Denver. 1 year ago, I stood on this same stage and looked out. Over 600 members of our community gathered together in celebration of International Women's Day, Women in Sports, and the mission of World Denver to promote international exchange and global engagement. 1 year later, a whole lot has changed, but our commitment to the mission has not changed, not one bit. And you can learn more about our work, get involved, and see some of our upcoming events, and join us at worlddenver.org. Now, before I present our keynote conversation, and I'm so excited for everyone to see this conversation, allow me to take a brief moment to thank some of the talented and dedicated women who worked hard over the last several months and so many Zoom calls to make this event happen, including our entire International Women's Day event committee. and the amazing staff of World Denver, especially Director of Development and Communications, Lauren Oska, and Membership and Events Coordinator, Talia Reynolds. And of course, to our event chairs, Ambassador Catherine Ebert Gray and Jamie Landers, where would we be without our event chairs? Finally, thank you once again to our sponsors, presenting sponsor Lockheed Martin, who were valuable partners and thought leaders throughout the entire planning and execution of this event. And to the Medal of Honor panel sponsor, Cigna, whose support made it possible to bring together that all-star panel of women who lead in national security. And thank you once again to all the companies, to all the corporations, to all the individuals, to everybody, all the classroom sponsors, whose support not only made this event possible, but will also fuel our mission all year round. With that, I'm proud to present our keynote conversation. It's a perfect culmination for our program and the complement to the broad array of women leaders who we've been so fortunate to hear from today. A conversation led by Marie Berry, director of the DU Inclusive Global Leadership Initiative, between two women, Ambassador Gina Abercrombie-Winstanley and founder of Girl Security, Lauren Bean Buitta, who pushed through barriers and adversity in their own careers in security and are now working to build a much more inclusive and representative next generation of women leaders in peace and security. And before I hand things over, allow me 1 minute to talk to the men. Men who are joining today, thank you for being with us, and I will encourage you to put allyship, to being good allies and making allyship right there at the center of your own personal word cloud, not just today, but every day. So with that, Professor Berry, take it away.
Good afternoon. I'm Marie Berry, Associate Professor and Director of the Inclusive Global Leadership Initiative at the Joseph Corbell School of International Studies at the University of Denver. I'm pleased to welcome you to the International Women's Day keynote conversation on building the next generation of women in peace and security. I'm delighted to be here with Ambassador Gina Abercrombie-Winstanley, a career ambassador and co-founder of the Leadership Council on Women in National Security, along with Lauren Bean Buitta, founder and CEO of Girls Security. Let's get started. Ambassador, I wonder if we can start by hearing you tell us the story of your impressive career, from growing up in Cleveland to serving in the Middle East to your work with the National Security Council and the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. You've clearly been called to leadership in service of your country. When did you first recognize that call?
Well, thank you. I grew up, as you say, in Cleveland, Ohio. I have returned there, which is a reminder of why I went to the Middle East, because we have massive quantities of snow outside my window. So leaving Cleveland, going to Washington for university and getting exposed to the international affairs field, whether it was internships on Capitol Hill or all the think tanks that are in and around Washington, D.C. I mean, it's really heady stuff for a young person coming to that city. I did 2 years of Peace Corps in the Middle East after doing a year abroad as an undergraduate at Tel Aviv University. And so my interest in the Middle East really came from that time, having Arabic and Hebrew as languages under my belt. The politics of the region are so evocative, and it has seemed from the time that I was a student that some sort of solution, peace, was just around the corner with just a little more attention, a little more goodwill, a little more focus, some more suggestions. And so that part of U.S. policy that chases peace was very interesting to me. So Johns Hopkins University and into the State Department, where I spent most of my career in the Middle East, sometimes working on Israeli-Palestinian peace, sometimes working in different parts of the region. A place where I got to know a lot of amazing history that many Americans are unaware of. You know, we're very focused inwardly. And knowing how much history of war and peace and effort has gone on before we even became a nation was you know, eye-opening and something that I learned early on that Americans can have a part in trying to resolve. Most of the time, as I said, in the Middle East, but because of that, you often touch on issues of war and terrorism. And so after surviving a terrorist attack in Saudi Arabia, I began to focus more on countering terrorism. How does America make partners to stamp out this scourge that ruins so many lives, ends and ruins so many lives? What is the role for countering violent extremism? What role can women play in this? And although many people think of women as victims, we are also part of the solution and we can be perpetrators as well. So looking at the full array of how to move us to the solution side. So after all of that time in the Department of State, I have also stepped back and in my brief retirement have spent a lot of time recruiting for the Department of State because it is an amazing opportunity and we need more women and we need more minorities. And hearing that from someone who's had such a fulfilling career, I find I'm a really excellent recruiter for the Department of State. And then speaking on women, peace, and security and moving that glass ceiling for women in national security affairs. And that's how I came to be a co-founder for LC Wins.
That's just so fantastic and wonderful to hear about such rich experience, as well as what you're continuing to do to improve kind of the security and kind of diplomatic space writ large. I think it's wonderful. And Lauren, I want to just turn to you now and ask you to tell us a little bit about what motivated you to create Girls Security, which is a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization committed to empowering girls in national security.
Well, I usually start by saying that I'm kind of the moral of the story with Girls Security. I grew up in rural Illinois and didn't have access to a lot of the programs that a lot of young people had, like Model UN and things like that in high school. But I was always very interested in war and military history and human suffering and sort of understanding why do we make decisions that result in human suffering. And then during my undergraduate experience, my junior year, 9/11 happened. And I think like most young people at the time, I wanted to do something, but I didn't quite know what that thing was. I had been studying political science at college. So I returned home to Illinois and my brother was deployed to Iraq. And I was hired by a small national security think tank in Chicago. And we had a wonderful kind of portfolio working with organizations, particularly in Washington, DC, on national security law issues. So I spent a lot of time in my early 20s learning about things like the authorization for the use of military force, worked a lot on the Patriot Act and understanding a lot of the provisions and the implications of those provisions on civil society. And I had an employer at the time who, despite my commitment to the work, mistreated me and then treated me inappropriately. And so I had to resign from a job that I really loved while I was working and in law school. Which was a huge pivot I had to make because I was really committed to the field. I was young, I was in Illinois, I didn't really know what I was supposed to be doing. And fortunately, through a connection that I made through that work, I was given the opportunity to take on a client that enabled me to start my own consulting firm, which I did in Chicago, working on urban security. And through that client, through that work, a mentor of mine actually who has roots in the Denver area, he died last April, I ended up managing one of the largest federal lawsuits against the city of Chicago for racial discrimination and civil rights violations in affordable housing. And so after I completed that work, which was really a privilege because I'd grown up in the city, I knew how highly segregated it was, but it really gave me an opportunity to see how racism becomes systemic to the point that it's almost imperceptible and how much time and commitment and investment is required to make any kind of change. And so this was right around 2015, and disinformation was on the rise. So I kind of combined the experience that I had working in national security and encountering a lot of the barriers that I did as a young woman with the work that I did on Chicago on racial discrimination to create an organization that could empower girls from very diverse backgrounds in national security. And really, we kind of envision a space where what does national security look like through the lived experiences of girls? We want to see what that world would look like. Would it even be called national security? So that was really the motivation for the organization.
That's so fantastic, and so much synergy between both of your current priorities and passions right now. Ambassador, you know, while recent strides have indeed been made, there is still a widely recognized lack of diversity and representation of women, and as you mentioned, particularly women of color, at the Department of State, the Department of Defense, and in other national institutions. You have said that when you serve, there was rarely another person who looked like you in the room. Why does representation matter? And why is it in our national interest to have institutions that reflect the talent and the diversity of our country?
Well, I'd like to follow on something that Lauren said about the lived experiences helping to define national security and the solutions, the recommendations for how we improve our national security. And so therein lies the answer. If you don't have the full array of people at the table, you are narrowing, you are limiting your options to find solutions. So that's why it's important. There have been any number of studies out there that talk about the benefits of diversity, the benefits of inclusion when it comes to private sector corporate performance, when it comes to board functioning, when it comes to how you present yourselves overseas. And the United States has said that we value inclusion, that we are a melting pot of people from around the world. And if everyone sees our leadership not looking like what we say we are, it's sending a dilatory message. I'm reminded of Carl Rowan in the 1950s and 60s. He headed up our then U.S. Information Agency, the public affairs branch of our foreign policy establishment. And he had to write back to Washington and say, the treatment of African Americans in the United States, you know, the vision of dogs being sicked on Black people trying to get lunch at a counter or get into school, things that are basic rights in this country, are helping the Russians, are helping the Chinese make the point that we can't be trusted as we were having our great party competition around the world. Well, the reality is he was right, and this continues to be right. As you can see from the murder of George Floyd last May, the whole world watches and sees what we do, how we're treating minorities, how we're treating women. And as this administration takes steps forward, the accountability for them to do what they say they want to do. Right now, it looks great, and we are hoping it will continue that way. And that means we, as women and minorities, need to be in the room. It's good for the United States. It's good for national security. It's a no-brainer.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree. I couldn't agree more. And Lauren, really, at the core of girls' security is an effort to begin to close some of these gaps in representation across the security field. I love this idea that girls' security is creating the first of its kind pipeline for women in national security. So I'm wondering if you could tell us how you identify this next generation of diverse women leaders and give them the tools, the resources, and the confidence to break through barriers and ascend in traditionally male and traditionally white male dominated fields.
Yeah, it's. I think it's one of those challenges where we've tried to take an approach of kind of reflecting the openness of the field. In other words, you know, national security continues to be a very partisan notion across the country, as we've seen. The assumptions made about the types of careers that one can pursue in national security are, you know, strictly or usually military or intelligence. So we take a very open approach to how we engage with populations. We kind of seed a grassroots model in the sense that prior to the pandemic, we're actually traveling across the country and working with girls in communities in diverse areas. You know, we're mindfully trying to cultivate an ecosystem of girls who, let's say on the south side of Chicago, can talk about what security means to them versus girls in a more rural area, and kind of building consensus around some of those shared experiences, but also understanding the different unique experiences of security from girls from different populations. So we really just open up a discourse with girls. We actually start every conversation with, what does national security mean to you? And through that question, we really develop an understanding of their perceptions. And so we provide them with learning, all of which is equity and trauma informed. We work with adolescent mental health professionals to scale all of our work. So we basically create some learning modules, some foundations of national security so that they understand the basics of how primarily modern national security has been defined through the lens of white men, as you noted. And then we really empower them with skills-based training. So we take very high-level training that's been typically only available to men, you know, things like strategy and innovation. And we scaffold those skill sets for girls. Everything is non-technical. Everything is accessible. We didn't want lack of access to be an impediment to the type of training that we provide. And really, our goal is to say to girls, these are things that you do every single day. You wake up every day and you secure yourself in a society that fails to secure you. You're already really good at security. So let's just take these aptitudes that you have and draw them out a little bit. And then our mentor network is really such an axis of the work. We have a nationwide mentor network of women from all of the country, from all different national security backgrounds. And they commit to 6 months of mentoring a girl or young woman at that really key intervention point of junior, senior year of high school, first and second year undergrad. And then also through partnerships, you know, we partner with Women of Color Advancing Peace and Security and other dedicated organizations, amazing women of the intelligence community who can work with us to create, I think, not just a single pipeline, but many pipelines, because national security's pathways are so varied that we really want girls to kind of find their own space into national security and for us to be really kind of the service provider and say, here are the skills and support that you need to advance into national security's many pathways.
So terrific and so important. And it reminds me that, you know, as you ask all of the participants in Girls Security, what does national security mean to you? You know, I think so many people think of national security as the military or as, you know, nuclear weapons or the threat of militarized attacks. But, you know, this year in particular, at least for me, I mean, we're seeing, you know, we're living in a global pandemic, right? We are watching on the news catastrophic climate change related disasters. We are witnessing the rise of political extremism. And I think all of these things have really shown in clear terms that security means a lot more than bombs and tanks. I'm wondering if both of you can talk a little bit about the different facets that go into security and that go into keeping every person, not only in our country, but in our world safe. And how does gender matter for this process?
Lauren, do you want to start this time?
I'm happy to start. I think it actually, something that you said, Ambassador, made me think of something that one of the remarkable women who's an advisor, Sue Gordon, who was formerly head of ODNI, said, which was that Russia achieved what it sought to achieve without launching a missile or raising a weapon over the last several years in the United States in terms of disrupting our democracy and really weaponizing racial and gender narratives around national security. And so at least through Girl Security's lens, identity is, if we ask what is national security, then we talk about how does your identity shape your security experiences. So for us, identity, race, and gender are so foundational to the work that we're doing, even more so now where we will not talk about racism or misogyny and toxic masculinity within our program. Because I think from our vantage point is, you know, you have these highly gendered racist threats like disinformation, cybersecurity, AI, deepfakes. Girls are literally on the front lines, and girls of color have very different experiences, many of which we talk a lot about in Girl Security. So for us, there is this very important moment in time where if we don't empower girls with a security understanding, we really risk some backslide in other empowerment initiatives that have been developed to advance girls and women. And I think some of the threats that we see in the national security space, some of which I mentioned, like disinformation and deep fakes, risk not only to impact girls and women now, so we're not just talking about national security, we're talking about democracy and equity and equality globally, but it impacts their lives in the future workforce. You know, if you're a woman who's a political leader and you're afraid of being harassed or doxxed online, as a girl or young woman, you might see this and find that to be a deterrent. In the military, you know, the sexual assault and the doxing and the harassment of women service members is rampant. again, as a girl or young woman, you might see this and find this to be a deterrent. Same thing in cybersecurity. If we don't talk about these issues now and make them central to our national security discourse, I think as well as policy changes and advancements, both on government and industry, we really risk depriving girls of all the benefits that technology can afford, as well as all of the benefits that kind of a reawakening can afford, if that's where we agree we might be in the United States. And so for us, really centering girls' voices at the heart of what how we're talking about national security is timely and time sensitive, I guess, as well, is how I'd say it.
Absolutely.
Couldn't agree more. I would add to that while it might be convenient that there is a false hard line drawn between domestic and foreign with regard to national security, you know, the typical definition is strong military, strong economy. But when you boil it down to its basic, it is the life and livelihood of the citizen. That means you're looking at things that aren't just, is your military strong? But what is the state of your education? Are people being provided equitable and good education that allows them to make a good livelihood? What is it with regard to gun violence or health? And we see that with the pandemic, the inequities of access to healthcare has stripped it away from all of our eyes. You know, many people who were dealing with it knew about the inequities, but now all of us know about the inequities. And all of these are national security issues, you know, particularly education and gun violence. And then you think about, you know, how many deaths we used to suffer in the United States with regard to, you know, drink driving, and that it was women who got together and said, we have to do something about this. And if you're boiling it down to the life and livelihoods, then car accidents count. That's why women have a very strong primal role with regard to gun violence issues. And I believe are going to be that foundation that gets the change needed that is going to improve the lives of American citizens. And so, you know, they look like domestic issues, but the fact is when you're looking at life expectancy and financial health, those are national security issues, and absolutely these things come to bear. And women have a strong role because we, I don't want to say we think about these things more because it isn't necessarily, but we do.
Ambassador and Lauren, I really couldn't agree more. My research focuses on the impact of war on women. And so often we assume that the threats women face are coming from armed actors. And yet in the hundreds of women that I've met with over the years in places like Rwanda or Bosnia or Colombia or Nepal, so often the security threat is their inability to find clean water, their inability to feel safe within their own home, within their own family, right? All of these issues are security issues. And I just want to commend you both for making that so clear to this new generation of women and other minorities that are hopefully going to end up in the security field as a whole. And so, you know, to really wrap it up, because we have so many classrooms tuning in today, so many students, and I think all of your wisdom is so relevant for them. And I'm wondering if you could kind of give some specific advice to a student or a young person who is just starting to think about a career in security or in public service, perhaps even more broadly.
I have a quote. I'm almost embarrassed that it took me as long to find it, but when I did, I absolutely internalized it, and it has made a huge difference in how I live my life and how much I enjoy it. And the quote is from a little book, 86 pages long, chapter 4, and it is, "What would you do if you were not afraid?" And if you hold that, you will find yourself making choices that are really good for you, choices that are going to push you beyond what you think you might be able to do. If you just do what you really want to do, focus, find your path, your joy in life, and don't worry about the fear that comes with it, but it can propel you forward. What would you do if you weren't afraid? Then do that.
I think I'm going to take that advice as well.
I was going to say that's fantastic advice.
That's really wonderful advice.
Thank you.
I suppose I would probably send someone to girlsecurity.org if, you know, if anyone is watching and is interested in the space and you're looking for support, you know, that's why we're here, is to provide that kind of support for career interest and to really kind of peek your head into the field and figure out what types of subject matters one might focus on in college, the types of internships. But I would also encourage young people to be okay with non-traditional pathways and non-traditional studies. You know, things that we talk a lot about at Girl Security is that, you know, women's war poetry can tell you as much about strategy as some of the traditional doctrine. But really that just recognizing that, you know, people in positions of power tend to write the history, and that has been the case mm-hmm. certainly with respect to national security. And so really trusting your voice, your experiences, how unique they might feel at the time, it's likely that anyone can benefit from the narrative of others. So feeling confident in sharing your story, feeling confident in the expertise that you might develop from any part of the United States, from any background that you might have, and understanding that there's a place for it and that we need it in national security, which I think many people overlook as it's the most powerful political realm, not only in the United States, but the world. And so having more voices, as the ambassador noted, more diversity of voices is going to be quite transformative.
Thank you both so much. I want to ask if there's anything else you'd like to share with our audience tonight or this afternoon. Anything else? Final words?
I just want to say, yeah, I think we're at a really amazing, impactful inflection point time in our nation's history, a time where we are finally willing to look hard at how we've been conducting ourselves. And there's a quote from Isabel Wilkerson's book, Caste, C-A-S-T-E, an amazing read. It's an enjoyable read as well as having amazing information in it. But she basically says, we didn't build the house. We didn't build the leaky faucets or the uneven pillars or joist or beams, but we have inherited it, and fixing it is up to us. And so we are at this time now where, generally speaking, we are agreed we must fix it. And that means holding ourselves accountable and holding our leadership accountable. So do not be afraid to join these organizations, gather your voices together, and speak up and speak out as women, as minorities, and as allies. We have to do this together. But we have a chance to make real change right now. This is an exciting time to be in America and to be in the national security space.
I totally agree and love that so much. So I just want to
end it on, I don't need to reiterate, that was brilliant. So let's,
yeah.
That's a good final, a good period.
Great minds.
Absolutely. Well, you know, thank you both so much for your time. And to all of you watching, happy International Women's Day. And now let's go back to the stage.
Well, that's our program. Our thanks to all of the speakers, the presenters, the panelists, and the honorees, and a special thanks to our valued sponsors and individual supporters.
I'd also like to take a moment on behalf of everyone here to thank all of the staff and production crew with us today in the Sewell Ballroom for our live broadcast from the Denver Center for Performing Arts. The full video from today's program will be posted on the World Denver website and our YouTube page. I'd also like to remind you to join us on March 18th for Forging New Paths in National Security discussion and to continue today's conversation. Please share this event with others throughout your friends, your family, and your social networks on worlddenver.org.
We'll all be together again next year to celebrate International Women's Day 2022. In the meantime, register for our upcoming events at World Denver, become a member, or make a donation to show your support for international exchange and global engagement at worlddenver.org.
Thanks again, and have a wonderful International Women's Day.
With your quiet voice.
Lucy Liu, with my girl Drew, Cameron D and Destiny, Charlie's Angels, come on. Question, tell me what you think about me. I buy my own diamonds and I buy my own rings. Only ring your celly when I'm feeling lonely. When it's all over, please get up and leave. Question, tell me how you feel about this. Try to control me, boy, you get dismissed. Pay my own corner and I pay my own bills. Always 50-50 in relationships. The shoes on my feet, I buy. The clothes I'm wearing, I buy. The rock I'm rocking, I buy. Taught and sacrificed to get what I get. Ladies, it ain't easy being independent. Question, how'd you like this knowledge that I brought? Bragging on that cash that he gave you is the front. If you're gonna brag, make sure it's your money you fund. Depend on no one else to give you what you want.
The shoes on my feet,
I'm
the clothes I'm wearing,
people love angel style.